Hello, 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 and welcome to this special episode of Movies That Pop, celebrating the best films of 2017. Now, this year's list was a difficult one to make, as it is every year, especially the late portion of the year, as the usual onslaught of Oscar hopefuls surged into theaters, and there simply was not enough time to review all of them for you in depth. That being said, I certainly tried to see them all, and I think I have enough information to make this list. In fact, there were quite a few movies that I saw this year that I didn't review, usually because I saw them late in their release cycle, when a review would no longer be timely. Some may have even made it onto this list. Just saying. As for the year as a whole, it was a year marked by divisiveness and controversy. I won't really get into the wave of misconduct claims leveled at a huge number of Hollywood men, other than to say that the outrage regarding the behavior of individuals has spilled over into outrage over the comments that other people have made in response to those individuals, with everyone weighing in on whether so-and-so's apology was sufficient, or whether an innocent celebrity who wasn't accused of any wrongdoing at all, but merely asked about the wrongdoing of others, gave a statement that was sensitive enough, or too judicious, or not condemning awful behavior enough. Even as was the case with Meryl Streep, the innocents suddenly have to prove to the public that they didn't know this misconduct was going on, and therefore weren't complicit in the cover-up. It's gotten really ugly out there. That ugliness has spread throughout the industry and tainted not just individuals' reputations, but the reputations of the films those individuals have worked on throughout their entire career. And even in the case of all the money in the world, it's resulted in changes to the films themselves. Also getting ugly is the state of film criticism, an art form on which I pride myself, and film fandom, of which I consider myself a member. Films like Justice League or The Last Jedi inspired a firestorm of outright lunacy online, with quote-unquote fans doing everything from issuing credible threats against critics to starting online petitions to get a studio to release the cut of a film that they wanted. It got completely out of hand. I believe Sam Adams of Slate said it best when he tweeted, "I'm so old I remember when fans were people who liked things. What's it mean to be a fan now? Well, you spew hatred online, accuse critics of taking bribes, and organize campaigns to artificially manipulate the Rotten Tomatoes or IMDb audience score just so you can label professional film critics as fake news. Gone are the days where people have mature discussions about the pros and cons of a movie online. Heck, gone are the days when people admit with honesty that a movie even had pros and cons. Now it's either all or nothing. It sucks or it rocks. My way or the highway. If you didn't love it or hate it with the fervor that I have, then you're biased, you're stupid, or you're wrong. It's just the worst byproduct of online fandom. You only support that which tells you what you want to hear, or that which legitimizes your opinion. Ugh. Now, I use all of that as a preamble to my top 10 list, because I hope, as my viewer, that you are better than that. This is my top 10 list, based on how I see it. And I can't wait to hear yours. I promise I will listen attentively and give you the benefit of the doubt, because we're all in this together, and we like what we like. These are the movies of 2017 that I, the Colonel, liked the most. Okay? Now, I'll start with some honorable mentions. There are movies that I quite liked, but didn't quite make the list. Much to my surprise, a lot of them were comic book superhero movies, in what was probably the best year for the genre in history. Justice League notwithstanding. What can I say? I was thrilled all year long by the likes of Wonder Woman, Guardians of the Galaxy 2, Spider-Man Homecoming, Thor Ragnarok, and even the Lego Batman movie, which was incredibly entertaining. Now, there may even be a comic book superhero movie that placed inside my top 10 this year, so please stay tuned for that. I was thrilled, I was challenged, and perplexed and entertained thoroughly by the most divisive Star Wars movie yet, in The Last Jedi. I was enraptured by Phantom Thread, scared to pieces and then put back together again by the adaptation of Stephen King's It. And I was charmed by a little indie that I didn't make a review for, The Big Sick, a very funny and subtle human comedy that you should definitely stream on Amazon Prime right now. All right, now without further ado, the top 10 films of 2017. Number 10 is a film that I initially gave a large bag of popcorn to, and that I have since seen a few more times on Blu-ray, and each time it gets better, and that's Jordan Peele's pitch-black comedy, Get Out. Peele really nails the tone of creeping, racially-tinged paranoia, which evolves into a deeply unsettling horror film. My minor quibbles with the film's ending have dissipated repeat viewings, and I just love watching how smoothly this plot escalates, and how many layers the movie works on all at once. Number 9 is a movie that may be even more divisive than Star Wars The Last Jedi, and all I can say is, well, I'm sorry if you don't love this one, but it feels like it was made just for my musical's loving heart. And so guess what? I'm getting on the train, okay? You're free to be left on the platform if you want, as we're all going someplace magical, and that's the Big Poppy, Romantic Sloppy, The Greatest Showman. Yes, I love this movie, and I don't even care if you agree with me. The tunes are catchy as hell pop numbers, the singing and dancing are first rate, and the plot, well, look, I think if this thing had debuted on the stage, it'd have been a massive hit. The story beats, the character swings, the broad themes, the loose interpretations of historical fact, it's all par for the course when it comes to stage musicals, and perhaps would have been easier to accept on the stage. For my part, I was fully willing to buy the ticket and take the ride, and I had a great time with The Greatest Showman. At number 8 is the number one reason I won't go to test screenings anymore. One day, this would be, I think, in late 2016, I was handed a flyer outside a movie theater inviting me to a test screening of an unnamed upcoming film. There was no info about the cast, the director, nothing. Turns out it was the first ever screening of Baby Driver. What I saw was a bit of a mess. Sure, some good action scenes, interesting premise, but the tone was all off, the story lagged, the romance was unbelievable, and certain characters evolved in really sudden and unrealistic ways. I was very down on it when I walked out, and of course, I didn't make a review of it at the time because, you know, that would be unfair to review a work in progress. Then, a couple weeks after Baby Driver was released, I caught a matinee of it just out of curiosity, and I loved it. I loved it! Here was a sharp, groovy, stylish, and very effective crime thriller with a charismatic lead performance from Ansel Elgort, a very satisfying romance, and probably the last time I'll be able to enjoy a new performance from Kevin Spacey for a good long while. Number 7 is War for the Planet of the Apes, which took an already great series of films across the finish line with poignancy and heart and a surprisingly smaller scale than the title, even the trailers, promised us. The last third of this movie has such potency, such catharsis, that it just elevates the entire trilogy to a very lofty place. To my ears, the score by Michael Giacchino is also the best score of the year, just as an FYI. At number 6 is a film I saw just last week, The Post. It's timely, it's full of details. I particularly love the vintage look of the way the paper is typeset and printed as stories develop in the pre-digital age, and it's made by a cinematic dream team who are all bringing their A-game. Go ahead and look at my channel for the full review when you have a minute. Now, a lot of people listed Dunkirk among the best films of the year, and while that film was well made and a very enveloping cinematic experience, I felt it lacking in context and therefore less compelling because of that. That context that I was missing is all over the film that I count at number 5, Darkest Hour, which follows Winston Churchill as he is brought to power in the very same moment of crisis at the very beginning of World War II. It has been said that this film would make for a great double feature with Dunkirk, and that is true, but Darkest Hour is the one which should be watched first. Gary Oldman gives a spellbinding performance as a man making impossible decisions in the face of a ruthless adversary abroad and dissenting factions rooting for his failure at home. I should mention that Lily James is very good in this film too. That makes her the first actor, I believe, to be in two different films on my top 10 list. So well done, Lily James. Last year, Ryan Gosling had that honor, appearing in both The Nice Guys and La La Land, and now we have Lily James. Well done. But she is not the only actor appearing in two films on my top 10 list. My number 4 movie of 2017 has a lead actor making his second entry into the list, and it's the only comic book superhero movies to make the top 10 list in a great year for superhero movies, and that actor is Hugh Jackman, and the film is Logan. And this is another one that benefited from repeat viewings on home video, because when I watch it at home, I can stop for breaks to pee. Logan is a very long movie, but it's epic in every sense. It tells a sprawling story of immense emotional weight, and despite the minimal amount of mutants in this film, in comparison to the other X-Men films, it manages to pack in some absolutely thrilling, yet brutal, action scenes. Logan is bloody and brilliant cross-genre filmmaking at its very best. Now, it would seem that Pixar always has a standing reservation on my top 10 list, and while that's not the case every year, they certainly earned their number 3 spot with their first musical, Coco, a movie that for the first time steeps itself not in an imagined world, but in an established culture, without sacrificing their sense of whimsy or attention to detail. Coco, which deals with family, legacy, and love stronger than death, proves once again that nobody grabs for the heartstrings quite like Pixar does. Now, when I walked out of my number 2 film, I was actually shaking a little bit, because I had just spent over 2 hours in a fantastical world, breathtaking in scale, gorgeously captured, and which told a very simple story about human nature in fresh and surprising ways. It was rife for interpretation, full of symbolic imagery, and fascinating from its first frame to its last. I was transported, I was challenged, and oh yes, I was entertained by Blade Runner 2049. Good God, this is a movie! Big and dense, and full of wonder, and I can't wait to pick this one up on 4K Blu-ray in a couple of days and dive right back in a few more times. I still can't believe this movie wasn't a hit. It actually kind of saddens me a little bit that achievements like this won't be rewarded, or will send a message to Hollywood that movies this audacious and so monumental aren't worth making because they don't make a profit. If you haven't seen Blade Runner 2049, do check it out. It uses all of the tools of cinema to absolutely blow your mind. And finally, look, if I walked out of Blade Runner 2049 shaking, then I was positively swooning when I walked out of my number one film of 2017, that would be Guillermo del Toro's romantic, hypnotic, gloriously designed and lushly photographed The Shape of Water. Now we knew del Toro had it in him, but I never knew it could be quite like this. Buoyed by some spectacular performances by Sally Hawkins and Michael Shannon, among others, this movie about monsters, both human and otherwise, is slightly more user-friendly than the challenging Blade Runner 2049, even though this one has a definite moment where you will either pull away from it or give yourself over to it. And I absolutely gave myself over to it. I tell you, it was close between the top two. Two great movies with impeccable production design, musical scores, visual effects, rich themes, masterful performances, and solid direction by confident storytellers, and an overall sense of wonder. One had a massive budget and ambitions to match, and The Shape of Water, a relative plucky underdog by comparison, squeaks out ahead because of its emotional pull. This was one close race for the number one spot, to be sure, and just by a nose, or a fin, The Shape of Water is the best film of 2017. That does it for this special episode of Movies That Pop. Don't forget to follow me, The Curl, on Twitter, at Movies That Pop, and click the icon right down there to visit our channel if you'd like to see more. While you're there, don't forget to subscribe so you can catch all of our other videos, and be sure to leave your top 10 films of 2017 in the comments as well. Think I was wrong? What would you have included? What would you have booted? Let me know. And in the meantime, thanks for watching. I'm The Curl, and I will leave you with my favorite movie line of 2017. I have been falling for 30 minutes!